My name is Bastien Sachet, and I'm the CEO of Earthworm Foundation. Earthworm is a not-for-profit organization whose mission is the regeneration of the soils and the forests of our planet. We've done this for over 20 years by working with companies that are committed to change and helping them answer three key questions. In this series, we will discover the women and men who are asking these questions. Join me to learn more about what drives them and their ideas to regenerate our world. Today, I have the pleasure to welcome Saskia Ozinga. Saskia is the founder of FERN, a European NGO that has focused for the last 25 years on forest campaigning with a lot of success. She's been on the board of TFT and then Earthworm, and is still on the board of Earthworm, coaching and guiding me in trying to drive impact. So Saskia, you created FERN 25 years ago. Why did you, get up and decide to create an NGO?
Well, I was working for Friends of the Earth Netherlands, and I realized that actually the Dutch government has very little power over import because that was all regulated at EU level. Mm-hmm. And so I started to learn about what the EU is, how it operates, how it functions. And I gathered together a lot of other NGOs in Europe, which are under the sort of umbrella of the Forest Movement Europe, to all start working together at EU level. And that's why I set up the organization, to basically inform campaigners in the EU about what EU is doing, what policies EU policies are, what we need to influence and why, and to make sure that the people in the EU, the bureaucrats particularly, but also the parliamentarians, knew what we were thinking and had sort of direct links with people in the forest as well.
And how did you do to, as you say, make the bureaucrats understand the reality of the ground and what they needed to do? Because they're in the office, they're very far from reality. So what was your way of doing that?
Well, really bringing people to them. Mm-hmm. To a large extent, when we're dealing with European issues, European people coming to the EU, people to talk with them. But also when we talk about tropical issues, getting people from the tropics to directly talk to people in the European Commission and in the European Parliament. And that really works best, because when they hear from people on the ground what's happening, they really are listening.
Over these 20 years of activism, of intense work, what would you say has been the biggest achievement of the organization, or some of the biggest achievements?
Well, I think at EU level, if you look at EU policy level, one of the biggest achievements was the regulation to ban illegal imports, mm-hmm. illegally sourced timber imports into the EU. And I think a second, hopefully likely success when it will be passed, will the new law on deforestation, because as you might know, the EU is now in the process of adopting another regulation to make it really difficult to put products on the EU market that are not sustainably sourced.
I remember when the legislation on timber passed, it was kind of a huge victory, because everyone was battling with voluntary initiative, making some progress, but not able to really set a standard. Do you feel now that the regulation is in place, the imports of illegal timber have drastically fallen into the EU? We hear some cases here and there, but it's nothing compared to what it used to be, is it?
Well, it's difficult. So what we do see is that some member states are very actively implementing it, but then the timber still comes in via another member state, which is much less actively implementing it. Mm. So it's certainly not watertight, and it needs to improve a lot. What also didn't work is that the penalties are very different in different member states. It's very difficult to prove that something is illegal. What makes the new regulation easier is that you need to declare as a company that your products are not having deforestation in their supply chain.
Okay.
And that declaration in itself is, of course, then a sort of legal document that can be used in the implementation. And the hopeful thing is, when you look at the new regulation, the deforestation regulation, which deals with all commodities, or with six commodities, they have really learned a lot of lessons from the EU timber regulation, what didn't work, which they've tried to remedy in the new one.
So it's a different approach now.
It's a slightly different approach,
much more constraining in a way, for companies.
Yeah. It's
in parallel, you were engaged with TFT at the time, the Forest Trust,
yes.
and now Earthworm, which work is very focused on companies.
Yes.
So how do you explain the complementarity and the need you found to be part of that as well?
Well, I mean, the public sector has to play a role, obviously. The private sector has to play a role, and civil society organizations have to play a role. They all have to play a role, and only when they play that role together and they play it well can we get the change that we need to see? So I think there is a clear role for Earthworm in really guiding these organizations, these private organizations, to do the things that they need to be doing.
It's interesting because what I always saw and what I discovered as well over the years I worked at Earthworm is that we talk about forests and we see trees and we imagine trees. But when we talk about forests in the tropics, we talk about land. And when we talk about land, we talk about people. We talk about land rights. And this applies to forests, but this could apply to mines. This could apply to every natural resource that is flowing into global supply chains from these countries.
Yes.
So in a way, very early on, your focus has not been just an environmental focus. It's been a social focus as well, isn't it?
Yes.
Land rights are critical. In a country where land rights are not clearly defined and local people don't have the right to their land, then we have a huge problem. Cameroon is a good example, where you have the case that the international law is in line with the customary law, but it's not in line with the national law.
One thing we've seen is that some concessions and companies end up paying the government the fee for renting the land, but they also end up discussing and paying the communities for being on the land.
Yeah.
And this creates a level of peace. Of course, it costs more to the company, but somehow it's a way to recognize both rights and pay for them in a way.
I don't know if you know about it, and I haven't looked at it in detail either, but I saw IOI recently had given land back to communities. I think it's the first case of an example where a company has given the land back to the communities, but I think that is the situation we need to go to in many other cases as well.
The work you've done on timber has had a huge impact. We're looking at this now regulation on deforestation. Deforestation has been accelerating in many places. Do you feel optimistic about the way things are going?
No, not at all. We have to change the economic system that is we are using now, because the economic growth concept is destroying the planet. If you look at sort of really old economists like Keynes and even John Stuart Mill, they all foresaw that there would be a moment in which the consumption was so high that you shouldn't increase anymore. And, you know, we have a 200 increase in economic growth since 1950. Yeah. We can't continue doing that. That's really clear. You cannot grow on a finite planet. So we have to find an economic system where we don't exploit the planet like we do now, but at the same time allow the basic social, healthcare, education, shelter, all that sort of things in place for much larger part of the population than is currently the case.
So the challenge we've got is we work with companies that are by essence growing to exist. The day they stop growing, someone else is taking their place. What does it mean for a company, and can this be envisaged at the level of a company, or does it need to be regulated actually?
I think it needs to be regulated. I think the first thing we need to realize is that there are limits, ecological limits, and that without these ecological limits, or without respecting these ecological limits, we can't grow our economy either. It's not, you know, it's often being put as the economy or the ecology. That's nonsense, complete nonsense. You can't grow economically either when you're destroying the planet. So we have to have a system in place, and I think that has to come from government regulated to force everybody to restrict those limits.
Today we feel that companies and investors in particular are starting to realize, okay, we've got a finite planet. The climate is not well at the moment. We need to take climate commitments. So we see this wave of climate commitment that companies have taken. What do you think of them?
We have about 350 billion metric tons of CO2 that we can still emit. Every month, we use 1% of that budget. So we have literally less than a decade left. And the quicker we start, the quicker we can solve things. So all these commitments, unless they're happening now and they're implemented now, and not made for 2050 or 2030 even, it's not going to really help. I mean, we have to really transition now. And I think we are in a crisis, but we're not acting like we're in a crisis, like Greta Thunberg always says very, very astutely. I mean, the crisis is, particularly in the Western world, not as visible as in some countries already in other parts of the world. But we are in a crisis nonetheless, and we have to act now, and we have to get this transition now. That's why when you ask me, are you positive, I'm saying no, because I don't see the movement, at least not at the speed that we need to see the movement to really create a change. And that's scary, that's frightening.
Somehow when we say the government needs to do that, but the government are those we choose ourselves.
So yes.
I think that sometimes when company demonstrate that something is possible, the government can be inspired and be confident that, okay, this is doable. We're not going to get the whole world of private sector against us. So I'm thinking maybe for the climate commitment, we we have companies that will just say things and not do anything, and others that will really implement that. What's your view on that, and how to encourage those companies that are trying to do the right thing?
Well, I think the role of companies is quite critical, and in a small scale, you can see it with the deforestation regulation, where there were companies, particularly business lobbies in Brussels, who were saying that we can't do this, the tracing back to source is too difficult for companies.
It was impossible.
They say it was impossible, and then Nestle, Ferrero came basically out very clearly saying, no, we can do this. We really want to do this, and we can do it. And I think, you know, those sort of signals are incredibly important to people in Brussels to show that actually these things are possible and that they should ignore this business lobby who says that these things are not possible. Mm. So signals from business are really, really key. And we need more of them rather than less. And particularly Ferrero, I think, is very upfront these days and very clearly in how they're going to lobby for these in a positive way.
Given the difficulty of making things happen on such big issues, and when you try to move an animal that the European Commission, it's not an easy thing. What keeps you going? What was the source of energy that kept feeding your motivation and making you come back at it?
I don't know. People often ask me how I started. I don't know. I've always been like that, and I think I'll always be like that. You know, these things are happening. We can't just let it happen. We have to do something to turn things around.
The sense of responsibility, basically, just to act.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you something around the campaigning NGOs at the moment. So you remember 10 years ago we had these big campaigns from Greenpeace, but somehow we've seen that with the climate commitments, the investors have kind of taken the measure of the challenge and they're pushing the companies to change. Mm-hmm. Companies are making massive climate commitments. Mm-hmm. And when you look at it, you feel like everyone's doing something about it. And some activist NGOs have gone more silent.
Well, I think the most effective organizations is not even the right word, are the sort of Friday for Future movements and the Extinction Rebellion movements. They seem to be the ones who are creating most waves at the moment and hence creating most change, which I think is really important. And I think the sort of more standard NGOs like the Friends of the Earth, the Greenpeaces, etc. of this world, they need to look at that and think, well, what's our role in this new context? And I would like to think that they need to go together with other movements, like labor movements, like refugee movements, like, you know, those sort of movements, to really create this economic change, to really create this different economic model. Because without that, I really cannot see how within the next 20 years we're going to get the transformation that we need.
One of my fears as someone who is really working to implement change, and you know, we're moving big companies and it's always a slow change. We see a real polarization of movements. So some people who said, you know what, we're all going to die, so I'm going to enjoy it till the end. And then you've got another group of people that are extremely violent and extreme, where nothing is good enough, basically. Yeah. And you mentioned some of those movements. How do we get a voice that makes, you know, people feel that, yeah, change is actually possible and there are things that are moving in the direction without greenwashing, but really keeping this kind of positive attitude?
I think you need a story. You need to know where you're going. You need to know what the steps are to go on that route. And you need to show people that it doesn't mean we go back to the sort of Stone Ages, which a lot of people say. And it also doesn't mean we go back to communist Russia, which is another sort of argument you often hear.
So Saskia, as usual, I have a question about our five values, which you know, truth, respect, humility, compassion and courage. Which one do you identify the most with?
Well, I think respect is critical, for sure. And truth is critical. Without truth, you don't get anywhere. But I think respect is undervalued often. And I think courage or challenging, I mean, in FERN we have a sort of value which is called challenging, which maybe overlaps with the courage in TFT or Earthworm Foundation values, which I think is, we need to be able to challenge, we need to be able to think critically. Otherwise we won't get the change out of it. We need to be truthful to ourselves and we need to do it in a respectful way by bringing other people with us. That's, I think, what I would say.
Saskia, thanks a lot. I think we've learned a lot and I still learn a lot every time I spend time with you. And I look forward to seeing you at the next board meeting.
Okay, well, thank you, Bastian. I enjoyed talking to you.
Thank you.